We always talk about disguise as though it's an onion, whether you're building it or whether you're peeling it off. It's almost transparent layers. And when you get enough of them going, you disappear and this other person is in the room. My name is Jonna Mendez and I was chief of disguise at the CIA. In my role as chief of disguise, my major concern was always protecting people, protecting our case officers who were going into situations that might be dangerous, but importantly, protecting the foreign people that we were meeting with, who were very often risking their lives. If you were working in Europe and you were meeting with a clandestine source at a cafe, your biggest concern might be that your next door neighbor was going to wander into that cafe at that moment and say, "Hi, Bill," when you weren't Bill. And that kind of casual stumbling upon people was an issue. And so you'd wear what we called light disguise. Light disguise can be something as simple as a wig, maybe some facial hair, maybe some glasses, not a big deal. The other extreme is advanced disguise that you would use for up close and personal for an extended period of time, or the person you were talking to would have no idea that you were not in TrueFace. One of the things that was going on when I was chief of disguise was an enormous research program into the new advanced disguise system. It was basically the masks that everybody always wondered if we used masks, and this was the beginning. This is a series of photographs of when I met George H.W. Bush in the Oval Office and revealed to him that I was briefing him wearing a mask. When you go to disguise a person, the general idea is that you're going to meet with someone in this disguise and they're going to write a memo of the person that they just met with. We want every item in that memo that describes you to be wrong. If we're looking at a man and we want to change the way he looks, start at the top, and the first thing that comes up is hair. What's he got, and what do you want to do with it? If he has curly hair, you want to go straight. If he has dark hair, you might want to go light. If he's young, you might want to throw in some gray. If he's old, you might want to cover up the gray. Do you present with facial hair? If you don't, maybe we're going to give you some. If you're going to be somewhere for a while, maybe we're going to have you grow some. We have made prostheses on occasion. You could actually change cheekbones. You can add something here. You can add a forehead. You can do a nose. We could do what we call dental facades. We can change actually the shape of your face with the right dental facade. This piece is called a plumper because it increases the plumpness of your gums. And when it does that, it changes the profile of your face. The last thing is artificial palates. We take an impression of the top of your mouth. They can change your enunciation. They can cause a slight lisp. It's a little bit different with everybody who wears one, but if it's enough, it's very useful. We very often discover that older looking men are considered less threatening than younger looking men, so we like to age a person. With women, you have a broader range of what you can do. You also have one extra step, and you could turn a woman into a man. I would mention that it's almost impossible to turn a man into a woman. What we do is always additive. We can make you taller, we can make you heavier, we can make you older. We can't go the other direction. You want to be the person that gets on the elevator and then gets off, and nobody really remembers that you were even there. That is a design goal at the disguise labs at CIA. Disguise isn't just all about the facial oval. It's about how you dress, how you present yourself in a public environment. Americans are oblivious to what it is that reveals them to a foreign crowd or a foreign intelligence service when they're out in public. In terms of behaviors, there are a lot of small actions that give us away. The way we eat, Europeans use the fork in their left hand and it doesn't travel back and forth to the right hand, whereas we're constantly putting down our knife and moving utensils back and forth. The way we smoke, we put it between our first two fingers. They tend to hold a cigarette between the thumb and the first finger. When an American stands, they tend to support themselves on one foot or the other. In Europe, they stand straight up. They don't lean on anything. Their weight's equally on their feet. Changing the way that you walk requires some amendment to what you're doing. You're going to need a physical apparatus to make you walk differently. You can't possibly say, okay, now I'm going to limp. To change my walk, I put a little piece of gravel in my shoe, just a little thing that pinches my toe, and it changes my walk whether I want to or not. You can put a a bandage around a knee, something that restricts you, will change your walk. Disguise can be applicable to you in your everyday life in terms of traveling around the world and staying safe. I would use Paris as an example. Anytime you approach Notre Dame Cathedral or those bridges that cross the Seine, those are places where there are groups of people that either want to pick your pocket or they're going to make some kind of trouble, and they cluster at these choke points. And if they can tell from your sneakers, if they can tell from your baseball hat, or a lot of other behaviors that we exhibit, that you are an American, you become a target if you just want to play it safe. There's nothing wrong with stopping in a local store and buying some local clothes. If you smoke, get some local cigarettes. You can always add a pair of glasses. You can always add some kind of hat. Just back yourself off from that American imprint that we all carry with us in so many ways. You know, all these things that we do are unconscious, and they are hard to change. If you have some friends who are thoughtful, you could probably sit down with a friend and say, what is it about me that is just a dead giveaway? And they're going to tell you things like, oh, it's your laugh, or it's the way you sit, because you always slouch down in the chair. They can help you find those pieces of your visual personality that are easy to get rid of once you know they're there. People have expectations of what you're going to present to them when you're being you. We try and brush those away. Quick change is the ability to clandestinely change your appearance. Typically, when you're out on the street, you're using the crowd as a mask. When we're doing this, we measure it in the number of steps, and then we rehearse whoever's going to do it. You're going to go in the gap. You have 37 seconds to come out with those changes. The goal of the quick change is to disappear. If you had surveillance and they discovered that you were gone, you didn't want them to think that you had escaped. You wanted them to think that they had lost you. It was their fault. Blending in is situational. It depends on where you are. You need to understand what the commonality is there, what this tribe is that you want to join. And once you join that tribe, you can typically move around freely because there's no suspicion. You can't summon up a disguise in the middle of an event, but going to the event, you can say to yourself, I think I'll leave my baseball cap and my sneakers, and I'm going to leave all of that in my room. And you can realize that being out on the street as an American is sometimes dangerous. One of our officers, probably working out of the American Embassy, would have surveillance 24 hours a day. They'd have teams of people following them. But they had work to do. They had to communicate with people clandestinely. And the extremes that we would go to disguise those people was the most interesting and the most challenging part of the job.
Bring it on.
Station, this is Wired. How do you hear me?
What's going on here?